Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm audible, right?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Friends, we have come to the finale session of this four-day seminar on ESOP valuation. The last couple of days, we have seen three different speakers. That is Anjan Babu, Samuel Mani, and Divya over four different sessions, that is including a bonus session, enriching us, who have taken us through this journey, equipping us technically, including giving us an understanding of the legal framework, giving us an understanding of the mathematical or the computational acumen that one needs to have before taking up an ESOP valuation assignment. So the missing piece of the puzzle is the subject matter of today's discussion, that is the reporting framework that one needs to be aware of in relation to ESOP valuation. In fact, we can call this session as icing on the cake, because this session is the only session that is standing between us and the task of taking up an ESOP valuation assignment more so confidently. So before I request Vikas Suresh sir to formally introduce the speaker, who is none other than the president of the Bangalore Valuers Association, CA Abraham Mathis, I have a small request. We will be sharing a feedback form to all the participants, both on the WhatsApp link as well as on the Zoom chat box. We request you to take a minute. It exactly takes a minute to fill up this form after the end of the session. Kindly give your feedback so that we can better our future sessions. On that note, may I now request Vikas Suresh sir to welcome the eminent and expert speaker Abraham Mathis, as well as give a brief introduction about Mr. Mathis, please.
Just a minute. I request the participants to download the file shared by Mr. Abraham Mathis. Meanwhile, all the participants can see, even the new participants can see the three files.
Yes.
This was shared by Mr. Abraham Mathis. Yes. No, yes. People have logged in before Mr. Abraham Mathis can definitely see. I'm worried whether all the participants can
see. Republish it, Shilpa. That's okay.
Okay.
Sure. Thanks, Shravan. This is Vikas Suresh here. And good evening, all. So it's a pleasure to introduce Abraham Mathis. And
video is off, sir.
Ravi, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, but your video is not on.
Okay. One second, maybe. I'm just trying now. Let me see if this works. One second. Yeah. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. This is Vikas Suresh here. And thank you for this. So it's a pleasure to introduce Abraham Mathis. And Abraham and I, we go quite a long way back when, you know, I was doing our RVO course together. So Abraham has over 30 years of experience and in two large organizations like Asian Paints and Infosys, where he has played, you know, key roles in the financial controllership side. And he's been also a CFO at Infosys just before he branched out, and he set up, you know, he became part of the advisory firm, which is Sarthena Advisors LLP. Now, again, on the topic of ESOP, which is quite relevant in today's time, which is, you know, as you see that more and more, you know, compensation payments in kind is becoming a practice, where people paying partly in cash and partly in kind becoming a prominent structure. And Abraham coming in from the industry with the experience of the industry side, I think it makes it gives a lot of rich exposure to the team here. And Abraham, over to you. All the best for this session.
Thank you, Vikas. Thanks for that introduction. And thank you, Shravan, for the setting the context. I think that just as a sort of housekeeping announcement, in case my sound is not good, I hope that you will tell me about it, because today the internet connection seems to be slow here, and I will immediately switch off the video at that point. What I've done, Shilpa, is that I've shared three files, which are the guidance note, the Ind AS 102 and also the SEBI guideline. All three are useful in preparing our report, and we'll refer to them from time to time. I will also shortly share an Excel sheet, which we will use while we are preparing our report. And let me also take this opportunity to introduce my colleague, Sai Kalyan. Sai Kalyan and I have worked on this Excel sheet, and we've used this for preparing reports for our clients. And he'll be able to take us through some of the cells in that Excel sheet. Now, this Excel sheet which we'll be providing is something which can be, it's a ready-to-use type of sheet. And I think that if you are in need of preparing a report, you can use an Excel. It's a simplistic model as compared to what has been shared already by Anjan, but it's useful for you in preparing a report. I believe that at the end of this session, together with the report format that we are going to share, that we'll be able to prepare a report, take up any assignment and prepare a report. Okay, so let me just start with my presentation, which is on the report.
The files are already shared in WhatsApp also.
Okay, thank you for that, Shilpa. Okay, so what we are trying to do is to give you a practice aid in the preparation of a valuation report. So let's assume that the situation is that you have been issued an appointment letter to provide a report on the intrinsic and fair value of employee stock options as per Indian GAAP. So what is it that you need to do? First and foremost, like we always do, we collect, subject to us getting the appointment letters and so on. So we collect all the information we need. We build an option model by populating the information obtained and gathering any other information which is needed. We populate the valuation report with numbers from the option model and modify the report parameters as appropriate. A report which I will share with you. What you have to keep in mind is that quite often in ESOP valuations, you can keep a simple format which can be reused from time to time based upon the engagement which you have. So moving on, the information that you need to collect would be the stock option plan, option agreements, the grant letters, exercise letters, termination letters, details of the shares issued, the ESOP register, previous reports issued, the financial statements for the relevant periods when ESOPs were issued, past valuation reports covering financial periods when the ESOPs were issued, and the board minutes to relating to ESOP. And if there are other information points which you believe need to be collected, please put them into the chat box and we'll use them. This is something which Harish was asking for earlier in the day, if I recall, in our WhatsApp group, as to what is the information which is needed to be collected. So here's an answer to that. Now, when we build the option model, and we have gone into the building of the option model with two of the speakers who have given us quite a good appreciation of what needs to be done to build this model. So we need the current price of the stock, the implied volatility, historical volatility. We need the risk-free rate. Let's assume for the moment it's a 10-year government bond yield, an exercise price, the time to maturity, number of options granted, canceled, exercised, lapsed and live, grant dates, time to vesting from grant date, spot price, strike price, dividend yield. So these are the parameters which we need. This has been prepared in a quite a simplistic manner. So the intention is that when people use this, they are able to understand it. It's not meant for those who are already experts at this, who already have the models. It's meant for any person who, out of the group of people who are there with us today, at the end of this, you should be having the confidence to prepare an ESOP valuation report on your own. You would have been enabled with the tools to prepare it. So what we've done, like Shravan has mentioned, is that we have told you how to build a model. We have also told you what to look out for by way of the legal implications. We are going to cover a bit of the accounting today. We are giving you the report format and we are helping you to build out the report. Now just look at the risk for the moment. The risk which is there in a report, in an ESOP valuation report, is actually, as compared to most valuations, it is much lower. Because what are we doing here? We are arriving at the compensation cost year-wise. And if you are using the intrinsic value, there is not even a calculation of the fair value of an option. Okay, so you're using data which has been provided, you're applying accounting guidance, and you're arriving at a cost which you're providing to the company. To my mind, the risk is low. And it's probably less risky than most valuations that you will be doing. Now, what should the report, what are the report parameters which are there? The valuation date, the report date, the option model used, whether it's the BSM or the binomial, and you recall that we also covered the Monte Carlo. The valuation standards you followed, the accounting framework followed, assumptions and limiting conditions, specify inputs used as appropriate, specify the information sources, and mention management representations. Now, therefore, what do we need? We need two things, the option model and the draft report. And let me hear just ask Shilpa if she can unmute Sai Kalyan.
Participants can unmute themselves.
Okay, so Sai, can you just unmute yourself? And if you have the option model with you, can you present that, please?
Yes.
Next time I will share the model with people.
Yeah. Sir, I think the model which I've shared, it has some problem. I'm not able to open it. Can I share the one which I'm currently using?
Okay, go ahead with it.
I'll share it with you.
Okay. Okay, so let me tell the participants that I have shared the ESOP valuation model, which I'd like to use, though Sai may be using a slightly different model. Sai, will you present your model?
Yes. I hope everyone can see my screen.
Yes, sir. It's good. Carry on, sir.
Yeah. So this is an option pricing model where we are basically using a Black & Scholes Morton model in order to derive the fair value of an option. So before going into the model and understanding all the parameters in detail, let me just step back and take a look at the just present the small presentation which I prepared for this. So as you already know, what is the definition of ESOP, etc., that I don't need to explain. But the one point which I need to stress here is valuing an ESOP is as same as valuing a call option. You know, as you know, call option is basically like a right, but not an obligation to purchase the shares of a company, which is at a predetermined date at a predetermined price. So keeping this in mind, moving towards a valuation of a stock option and the guidelines which are already defined for unlisted companies, typically a privately held company, the main objective of valuing this entire stock option is to arrive at the fair value of its option. At the same time, you need to derive the accounting value by keeping intrinsic value and fair value both in mind. So for this, ICAI has already provided a guidance note, which is GNA18, issued in 2005. This is basically recommended compared to Ind AS 102, which talks about valuation of share-based payments. The reason why we use this compared to Ind AS 102, because here you have a liberty to use two values, which is intrinsic value and fair value. Whereas if you compare it with Ind AS 102, it only talks about fair value. Let's just think in this perspective. See, whenever you are capturing the fair value, right, you are basically capturing a higher value when it comes to compensation cost in your P&L. So there you are ignoring the fact that you need to show the value which is exceeding the market value in your balance sheet as a notes to accounts. So that is the only reason why we need to use ICAI guidance note compared to 102, where it is clear that you need to derive the value according to intrinsic value method as well as fair value method. So moving on to comparing both of these two, intrinsic value method is defined as excess of market price of a share under ESOP over the exercise price of an option. So in order to understand this, let's just take a small example. Let's say company share price is trading at 100. So underlying price of that option is 100, correct? So
you're in the first worksheet. That is the same worksheet which we all have to follow. Is there any link to the worksheets, or we are just listening right now to whatever you're saying?
Just listen. I mean, I think this is not shared with the team.
Yeah. So Sai, let me just interrupt and then I'll ask you to chip in once again, if you don't mind. I will do, while I will go back to Sai in a moment, let me just ask Sai to go to one of the tabs in this spreadsheet, which is the, just take the life of the option and TTM, Sai. Okay, so when we are doing this spreadsheet, what we are trying to do is to figure out for each vesting, what is the life of the option and what is the, for each vesting, we calculate what is the life of the option. And we'll come back to this in a moment. Let's find out the, do you have in your spreadsheet the calculation of the options which are vesting, Sai?
Yes, sir. So for vest one, these are the number of options that are vested.
Okay, so hold on for a minute, Sai. I think that let me just take control and come back to you in a moment. If you'll just stop sharing the screen, I'll just share the Excel from here and then I'll just take through this. Just sorry to the participants, we'll just come back in a moment. Okay, so I think that when I told you that you need to find out which are the options which are granted, what you do is you go grant wise and find out all the vestings, all the dates on which the options have been granted. So 1st of August 2018, for instance, the vesting dates on which these options will vest. So for each vesting, you take out the vesting dates. You then calculate what is the intrinsic value using the market price minus the exercise price, and you get to an intrinsic value. And you need to work out these numbers, which are, what are the numbers of options which are granted, and based on this, the options which are lapsed as well, the live options which are there, and then you'll come to the compensation cost, which is basically multiplying the intrinsic value by the number of options which are live. And this you will do for each vesting. Okay, now after this, when you look at the amortization, what you will do is that you will amortize this cost based upon the periods over which you are going to be over the service period. So therefore you have a situation where the cost of an option which is going to be for 4 years gets amortized over 4 years. So Sai, you want to take a moment to explain this?
Yes. So we are going to amortize the cost of 111,012, which you can see in cell number 16, over a period of vesting and the end of the financial year. So for an instance, if you look at row number 18, so if you have to derive a compensation cost at the end of 31st March 2019, so you need to apportion it in a way according to the number of days difference between 31st March 2019 and the vesting date or the grant date, whichever is earlier. So that's what has been put into the formula. So the remaining cost.
Can you just repeat once? You said some proportional, you know, just once, please.
Yeah. So cost need to be apportioned over the period of time. So in this case, you are deriving the cost at the end of 31st March 2019, right? So the cost for this particular period would be the difference between 31st March 2019 and the vesting date, 21st August 2019. So that is what coming over here in cell number C18.
Right.
And the remaining cost has been, you know, apportioned for the next year, which is FY20. So likewise, you do it for every vesting in order to come up with the total cost of, you know, compensation, which you need to amortize at the end of every year.
Okay, just to say, basically, this is the option cost of the first year, which you can see as 1,11,012, which is divided across two accounting years. And that's what Sai is saying. Sorry. The first part contains the period up to 31st of March 2019, and the second part is for the next financial year. And this is something which you need to do for every grant which is there. So if you take the second grant, for instance, I mean, the one which is vesting on the second date, here again, you can see that the number which is being amortized is amortized over 3 years. Okay. And this is, even though this option is going to be live for 2 years, the service period is 2 years in this case, you're seeing that the cost is going across three accounting years. I think will be quite clear to all. Similarly, when you take the next vesting, you will find that the cost is getting amortized over 4 years and for the next option. So therefore you will get a cost based on this. What you'll do is you will get the cost, intrinsic cost, which is going to get accounted in the P&L across each of the years in which the vesting is going to take place. Okay. Now let me go back for a moment into the information which you need to collect for fair value calculation. If you look at what has been put here, what you can actually do is that you can link your report to the Excel so that when you prepare your report in a Word document, you can actually link it and take the values from out of this Excel sheet if you've linked it properly. So here you're putting in the parameters. Time for vesting from the grant date in terms of number of months would be 12. Exercise period is 60 months after the vesting date. The spot price, the strike price, and the dividend yield, which we have covered in our previous sessions. So now I will just request Sai to briefly take us, because most of the participants have been through the option models, to briefly take us through the risk-free rate, the implied volatility, and the granting date. The granting and vesting schedule is something which we'll have a look at before we go to Sai. You can take us through this OPM West 1, OPM West 2, and OPM West 3 side, and just explain how to use it in this spreadsheet. Now, coming back to the number of options, you would calculate in this manner, in this spreadsheet. So you look at the, here you have a case where options are vesting 10% in year 1, 20% year 2, 30% year 3, 40% in year 4. And therefore the cost in year 1 is 10%, cost in year the second grant is amortized over 2 years, 10% and 10%. The third grant is across 3 years, and the fourth grant across 4 years. And therefore you have the option cost being written off in 40%, 30, 20, and 10%. And you also have your workings as to the opening number of options, the options granted, the options lapsed, options exercised, the closing options in the pool. And with this, your model is more or less, you've got all the data which you need. I'll just pass it back to Sai to explain these parameters and in a simple manner, because I think that all the participants have already been through this.
Sure. So that's a similar kind of model even I'm using here. Since I'm not able to open the one which sir has shared, I'm using the one which I have it right now. So since we have defined what is the number of options that you need to value for West 1, West 2, and West 3, we need to also define what are the parameters that you need to use in order to derive the fair value of an option using the option pricing model. So for the team time being, we are using Black and Scholes Merton model in order to derive the fair value. Just to give a sense about BSM model, there are six parameters. You can look at these six. So these are, we call them as inputs. So these are essentially the factors which you need to be very certain. At the same time, when you are inputting into the model, you need to make sure those are, fairly correct in order to calculate the fair value of an option, since it will have a value which is beyond the intrinsic value. So we'll go through it one by one. So the first one is share price. So this is the price of an underlying. If you are valuing a company's stock option, the stock price or share price would be the share price of an underlying asset. So in this case, it is 12 rupees. So you can typically find this share price by looking into, company's equity valuation report. So that is pretty much simple. And the strike price is what is already defined in the ESOP policy. So this you can get it from the ESOP policy. Risk-free rate is the rate at which, investment has a less risk of default. So whenever you are using a risk-free rate of return, you need to compare it with the time to maturity. So I'll just move to a sheet called Life of an Option, TTM. So in order to calculate the time to maturity, you need to depend on two factors. One is a minimum value of an option and maximum value of an option. So deriving time to maturity is nothing but using a weighted average. So it need to be defined for all the three VES, VES 1, VES 2, and VES 3. So just look at this row number 21. For every VES, there is a different time to maturity, correct? So if you are trying to figure out what is the risk-free rate of return for the VES 1, the only thing which you need to look at is time to maturity for VES 1. Look at the VES 1 time to maturity. It is 4 years, correct? Now you look at VES 2, it is 5 years. Now VES 3, it is basically 6 years. I'm just rounding up in order to get a clear sense. So for every VES, time to maturity will differ. So whenever you are considering the risk-free rate of return, it is more appropriate to take the risk-free rate of return according to the time to maturity of that particular VES. So it just simply works in this way. If the VES has a time to maturity of 4 years, you need to look for a rate of return which has a less risk of default for 4 years. So that is what we are doing here. So in this case, you are relying upon a risk-free rate of instrument, which is typically like a Indian bond, treasury bill of India. So for 4 years, it is 6.2. 5 years, 5.58, and 6 years, it is 6.48. Maybe you can refer to any kind of a website where you can see all these bond rates. So that's what comes in risk-free rate. Okay, but always remember that risk-free rate is defined in such a way according to the time to expiry, or the T, what we call it as TTM here. Okay, the next one is average annual annualized dividend yield. So dividend yield is something, you can find it from, you can find it as part of your management representation letter. So management has to confirm by saying in the coming years, let's say 2 years, 3 years down the line, we are forecasting a dividend yield of something like, 0.5%, 0.6%, something like that. But if you look at index dividend yield, for an example, Nifty, the current dividend yield is about 1.6. So ideally, when you are valuing a private company's option, it would be much lower than that, somewhere around 0.5, 0.6. But for the time being, we considered zero as the dividend yield, considering this is a startup. And this is a stage one startup or stage two startup, okay? And the last one is annualized volatility. So if you are trading in index-based options, for an example, Bank Nifty or Nifty options, this is what we call it as IV, correct? Implied volatility. So this is nothing but the amount or, you know, changes in share price of that particular underlying at what percentage it changes for the defined period of time. For an example, I'll show you here. So this is how we calculate.
I think that Anjan has gone through this fair bit in detail, so do it fast.
Okay, sure. So this is how we typically calculate the annualized volatility of an option. So here I took benchmark as a comparable for the underlying. So based on that, we have arrived at annualized volatility for that for the BSM model. So by plugging all the six factors into the BSM model, you arrive at a call option price of 11.2 for West One. Can you see that? So that's what coming here for the West One. So even for the West Two, similar approach need to be followed by plugging in these six factors, which will typically change compared to West One, right? So if you plug in all the six inputs again for West Two, you will get a certain different value compared to West One, which would be slightly higher. The reason being time to maturity is higher. At the same time, risk-free rate of return is also changes. So similar way, West 3 is also calculated. So that's how you can see the fair value computation for an option with a defined period of time with the different six parameters at every point of time.
Okay, and let me go back to the report then for a moment, and then let me come back to this Okay, so let me just go back to the report now. You've seen what the Excel is going to look like, and you know how to use it. I think that because you've all been through the model with Anjan, you'll be able to get not only a Black-Scholes model, you'll also be able to get a binomial model. Now let's look at the draft report, which some of the people have been talking of. Like Srikant Kabra has asked, can I get a copy of the draft report? So here it is. So the board of directors report on intrinsic and fair value of ESOP stock options as per Indian GAAP. As requested, we have completed the valuation of stock options as per intrinsic and fair value method as of the date, which has been carried out as per the scope and terms of the engagement letter. The results of our finding are detailed out in the attached report. And here we... Now, this is a format of report which you can actually use. You can cut paste a lot of this. You can modify it to suit your purpose. And I believe that when you use this report, it will give you a report which is going to hold up to scrutiny. So you'll give the company background, the scope of the valuation engagement, the purpose of valuation, appointing authority, subject matter of valuation, identity of valuer, other experts. So you can refer to the reports, the valuation reports of other people. Valuation summary, the company's business review, the company's operations, business segments, corporate strategy, mission and vision, operating environment, industry overview, the information sources you've relied on, management representations, inspections and investigations undertaken, and then the valuation analysis. So here I've mentioned the rational use for Black-Scholes Merton, but suppose you're using one of the other models, you should give the rationale for it. The correlation between the variable and fair value of the option, the estimation of option values, various parameters used in estimation, the guidance note which you followed, and the assumptions, limiting conditions, caveats and disclosures. And then you would give these annexures which contain the fair value workings and the intrinsic value workings. So here you have a brief about the company.
Sample report?
This is a sample report. Okay, so this is a sample report, Ruchi. See, if you take this, this is actually giving you the report format.
Okay, yes, can you please share this file with us?
This file is shared. Okay, I will share this file with you shortly. Immediately after this presentation, I will share it with you.
Thank you so much.
Okay. So this will be available to you, so you can use it. So this company incorporated in 2010, telecom solutions company, etc., whatever it's doing. The company has issued stock options under the stock option plan. You define the plan to few of its employees. You have been appointed as the by the board of directors by its letter dated such and such to calculate the intrinsic and fair value of stock options. The purpose of the report is to calculate. So this you have to specify. What is the purpose of the report? You also mentioned the methodology used and detail out the various parameters used along with the rationale for the purpose of calculating the fair value of the options. Now, I hope that this is visible to you all. And if not, you'll have to tell me. Then I'll have
It's visible.
Okay. We have performed a valuation engagement of the stock options of the company as of 31st March. Valuation was performed solely to assist in the matter of computation of fair value of options granted by the company. The resulting estimate of value should not be used for any other purpose or by any other party for any purpose. Now, here you have to keep in mind that this valuation report is actually not going to be used for income tax purposes. Okay. This report is going to be used just for the accounting cost for income tax purposes. And in that session, which will be taken later by Uttam Padiwal, you will realize that the calculation of cost in the for income tax purposes as far as the employee is concerned is based upon the fair market value on the date of exercise. Okay, so that is a separate matter. The valuation engagement was conducted in accordance with the guidance note, and in case you're using Ind AS 102, you have to mention Ind AS 102 here. The estimate of value that results from the valuation engagement is expressed as a conclusion of value. You have to mention the dates of vesting, exercise and vesting. We were restricted or limited in the scope of our work or data available for analysis as follows. See, quite often what you will find is that when you get into companies and in the startup companies that we deal with, you'll find that the record keeping is not great. So you have to go on the basis of reports which have been filed with the MCA and which would detail out the stock options which have been granted. You have to see whether there is an ESOP register. And if there are limitations, if there is inadequate documentation, you have to draw them out. Based on our analysis, as described in this valuation report, the estimate of value of employee stock options on this date, you will mention the value. This conclusion is subject to the limiting assumptions and limiting conditions and to the valuer's representation found in the section of the report. We have no obligation to update this report because this is valid as on the date of this report. So this is the information which you need to populate some of the points which are marked here. Moving on, you will mention the overview of the company's business. And then moving on, the sources of information you will outline. You will also mention, make sure that whatever you're getting by way of a representation from management, you actually capture it in a letter, in a management letter. You document everything so that you can rely upon it later. And make sure that you refer to the ESOP registers, the grant letters, and the related board minutes, which you have referred to. Now, you need to put in a bit of the analysis which you have relied on, the methodology which you have followed. So here, I've given you a draft of what can possibly be used. And it's up to you to change this and as it suits you. So here, there is something which says that it's because human capital is the core driver, it's important to retain talent, and therefore we are using a stock option plan. Now, this is data which you can actually pull out from the company's board minutes because there will be a logic and a justification quite often as to why they're giving stock options. So that's something which you can capture. You mentioned which is the guidance note which you're following, and then the justification for the BSM model. So all of this we have covered already. It is just a detailing out for the purpose of your report in terms of what you can potentially put into your report as to why you have used a Black-Scholes model and so on. Now, you also should take care to mention in your report the valuation standard which you're using. So if you're following the valuation standard issued by the ICAI, you refer to that. If you're following some other standard, please refer to that. So here we are drawing a conclusion that the Black-Scholes and the binomial are based on the same theoretical foundations and assumptions. We've gone through this, and you know why the two values could be different. But here what we are giving is a justification as to why the binomial can potentially be, why the binomial model basically could give a value which is similar. And therefore, that's why we are using the Black-Scholes model. So we are saying that the binomial model converges on the Black-Scholes methodology if the number of binomial calculation steps increases. And this is something which also we have heard from two of the speakers. And that's what has been detailed out here as to why you can use the Black-Scholes model, even though because it approximates whatever is the valuation which could come from a binomial model. This table is something which you've been through with the other speakers already. The variables as to what are the changes, this is something which you actually capture in your report. So this is a good thing to capture in your report because it indicates that you have done an analysis, you've understood all the factors which have been considered in the report, and you've detailed them out in your report. Now, the estimation of option values is where, coming back to, and here I will hand off back to Sai, because this is what he was explaining to you just now. Now, you saw the table which Sai was presenting upfront, and what you're doing is that you're just capturing that table and putting it into your report here. So, Sai, I'm just stopping the share here, and you just go through the what you were doing at that point of time, please.
Yeah, so what I thought of doing was, since you are capturing all the six parameters in order to define the value of an option, I thought of, giving some sort of explanation why these factors will change and ultimately how would it affect in the fair value computation of an option.
Okay, so Sai, in your spreadsheet, if you can just cover that, it would be great. Because see, most of the people have already seen this. Okay, so let's just go to the spreadsheet and take it from there itself.
Okay, so I'll use this summary sheet, estimation of option value, as a reference point.
Yeah.
So you can see it here, spot price, which is nothing but...
Sai, you have to stop share and just look at it again. Are you showing it from this PPT or from the Excel?
Excel.
Okay, stop the share and share again. Share the Excel. Yeah, carry on.
Yes, as you can see in row number 8, share price of a company, we are considering it as 12 rupees, which is constant over the period of 3 years. The assumption is that the moment when you started valuing this option, which is nothing but as on the grant date, which is 6th November 2019, the spot price of a underlying is 12 rupees. And at the same time, if you look at implied volatility, so this is what we need to put little effort in terms of calculating and arriving at the implied volatility. So even implied volatility wouldn't change, assuming that valuation date is nothing but the grant date. So this you can derive by using closing prices of listed comparable for the company with similar characteristics or similar market cap or similar business model. So that's how you can calculate the implied volatility. So for an example, and for the time being, what I did was, assuming this company is in the software and IT industry, I relied upon underlying share price changes of a Nifty IT index, which certainly gives a much more clear picture. So taking at the closing prices for the last 365 days, so that's the reason we are defining it as a annualized volatility, which is nothing but share price movements for the past 1 year. So we have arrived at the annual volatility according to two methods. Method one is basically relying on log numerical distribution. Method two is, calculating it from the daily returns. So both are same. There'll be, a decimal kind of difference. So that's how you calculate the implied volatility of an option. So this would also stay as same for the all the vests whenever you are valuing at certain point of time. So in this case, it is 6th November 2019 as a grant date. So risk-free rate of return, so this is what will change at every vesting period. The reason being, you have a different time to maturity for every vest. So whenever there is a high time to maturity, your risk-free rate also will change according to that. So in order to define the risk-free rate, you need to depend on certain market parameter, which is nothing but risk-free rate of a bond, Indian bond. So in this case, for West One, for an example, you need to see risk-free rate for an Indian bond, which has 4 years of time to maturity. So based on that, I'm defining it as 6.22. Okay. For West Two, the time to maturity changes, correct? 4.5. So taking it as a round figure, 5 year Indian bond would yield 5.58% of return. And for West Three, compared to the previous West, it is higher, right? So the time to maturity is almost 6 years. So 6 year government bond would yield 6.48. So that's how the risk-free rate will change for every vesting period. And the strike price is same.
So
this is what already defined in our ESOP policy or from any document which essentially talks about the strike price. Even a grant letter would also define the strike price for that particular employee or for that particular option, correct? So dividend yield, this is something where you need to rely on certain management estimates in terms of future performance of company, in terms of earnings. At the same time, how much would it yield in terms of dividend for their stakeholders and shareholders?
Okay, so sir, let me just stop for a moment and take this time to maturity. Now, what we showed you in the report is that all these parameters are going to get captured in the report. Now, let's look at this time to maturity and go to your tab which shows the time to maturity side. See, what you've seen is that the what we've done is that we've taken an average. So, Saib, if you'll just click on that, how we've got that 3.5 years. So, what we've done is that we have said that in order to convert it from the binomial to, let us say, the Black-Scholes, the Black-Scholes needs a fixed time to maturity. So the assumptions which we are making in this model are that the time to maturity is going to be 3.5 years, which means that most of the people are going to be exercising it over a period which averages out to this. Okay, so if you recall the discussions which we had previously, we said that we will try to segregate the classes of people to whom options are given. We will understand the behaviors of the different classes. So for instance, suppose the top management lets an option run till its end, then your maximum life of the option, you will actually assume that the time to maturity may be 6 years. Okay, so you will take a different maturity for the purpose of calculation in your Black-Scholes model based upon the behavior. So this is a modification which you may need to make in the model. However, if there is no such, if you want to have a general assumption, then you can go with this. You go on the basis of having an average, which is that you've taken the minimum life of the option, the maximum life of the option, divided by two, and say that on an average, people are going to exercise it in 3.5 years. Okay, so this is somewhat questionable, but it's something which can probably hold. Okay, so Sai, I think that let me just go back to the report and then I'll come back to you in a moment, if you can stop the sharing of the screen. Okay, so coming back to the report which we have, you saw the report where we pulled the data out of. Now, what you will do is that since the shares of the company are not listed, the stock price has been considered based upon the share price of XYZ estimated during the share issue exercise at that time. So basically, you're referring to the last valuation report. And all these parameters you get out of management. So you make sure in your management representation letter that management is actually saying that they're not going to declare a dividend. They don't anticipate that they'll be declaring any dividend. This is something which you can put into your report. The next is that the various parameters used, these are just an explanation of whatever we have been speaking of so far. The stock price, how you will explain in your report as to what you are considering for the purpose of the stock price based upon the valuation report, the expected volatility, which is going to be there. And if you follow whatever, let us say, Anjan Babu has given you, if you are following a historical volatility, you follow that implied volatility, you follow that. So you put down how you've got your volatility. The factors which you are considering, implied volatility, historical volatility, the length of time, the shares of the enterprise, the tendency of volatility to return to its mean, appropriate and regular intervals for price observations, etc. So all of this you're detailing out in your report, and this can be used by you. You may make a few modifications in your report, but this is how you can actually detail it out in your report. Now get to the guidance note and outline in the guidance note as to what it says. So we'll go into the guidance note for a moment, which is already with you. The guidance note issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants recommends using the historical volatility of the stock over the most recent period that is generally commensurate with the expected life of the option being valued. Now, what you'll have to make sure is in this report, when you're using it, make sure that the statements which you're making are consistent. So if you're following something which is, if you're stating here that you're following a certain, what the guidance note says, make sure that the rest of your report is consistent with this. The guidance note also states that an enterprise should not base estimates of volatility on historical information without considering the extent to which experience is expected to be reasonably predictive of future experience. So this is like we discussed briefly beforehand as to what is the likely period, the life of the option. Here you outline the parameters also which are affecting the fair value of the option, and you can explain further about the volatility. Okay. So moving on from here, the risk-free rate of interest, this is what Sai has mentioned. And you can detail out, therefore, in your report as to what you have done to capture the risk-free rate of interest. And the sources from which you've relied on, you can mention that if you need to. But this report basically gives you something which you can use. Here you explain the exercise price, the time to maturity, the life of the options. So here you can see the average length of time of similar grants have remained outstanding in the past. If the company does not have sufficiently long history of option grants, the experience of an appropriately comparable peer group may be taken into consideration. The expected life of stock options should not be less than half of the exercise period of the stock options issued until and unless the same is supported by historical evidence with respect to stock options issued by the company earlier. So as the company becomes, as you have more history, you can go back in history and see what is the exercise history of the company for you to outline whatever is the parameter which you're using here. Here again, you can see the we are capturing whatever is the vesting period of the particular tranche of the grant, and you've come to what is the half of the time period, how you've calculated. I've shown you in the Excel sheet as to how you take half the time period. The dividend yield, you'll outline into your report. And then you then refer to how the accounting is mentioned. So we'll go to the guidance note in a moment. Basically, you're saying that options can be either equity settled, cash settled, or employee-based share payment plans with cash alternatives. And based on this, the employee has a choice of whether the enterprise settles the payment in cash or by issue of shares. And you can mention what is the, see, this is giving you something which you can actually incorporate into your report. You can outline what the statement says and what you are following is basically what is the principle to be followed here. Okay. And therefore, based on this, you come to what is the compensation cost, which has been computed separately for each grant. And we'll go into the standard for a bit here. See, the intrinsic value we showed you already in the Excel model, but for good, we'll just take you to that once again. Just give me a moment and I will share what is the what is it that you will put in here. Sai, will you share whatever you're showing in the intrinsic value model? Sai, will you share the intrinsic value? Okay, so this is what you'll actually populate into the report. Here you're capturing a table from your Excel. You can probably cut and paste and put it into your table. Okay, Sai, you want to explain anything further on this? This is basically just a cut and paste job after you've worked your model, right?
Yes. So intrinsic value is nothing but the difference between market price and exercise price. So which is again, you know, multiplied by the number of shares outstanding for that particular vest, which is amortized over the period of time. So this can be, you know, copied from here. You can directly paste it into the report.
Right. And the next annexure will actually be the fair value. So here again, we have got a table which has the fair value. And this is actually formatted for you to just cut and paste and take it into your report. So here again, at the bottom, you can see what is the cost for the year ended March 2020, and the fire values can be captured and can be put into a report. Now, therefore, it is a matter of what is it that the standard requires by way of disclosures, because you've got all the information which you need out of your Excel, you've got a report format, you know where to plug your information from the Excel into the report. So therefore, now let's look at the accounting standard and see what it has to say. Can you just, all of you have with you already the guidance note, and let me just take you through parts of the guidance note which are relevant to me. The guidance note which I've shared with you has actually been highlighted in specific points, and I'll run through that now. See, if you see the guidance note, it covers a lot of the questions which all of us had. So we have stock option plans, stock purchase plans, stock appreciation rights. So the stock appreciation rights can be either cash settled, or they can be settled with shares or equity settled. So the guidance note recognizes that there are two methods, the fair value method and the intrinsic value method, as an alternative. Now, let me stop here for a moment. And Sai had mentioned to you in the beginning that intrinsic value is a preferred alternative for most because the price of the option is not considered. Now, the option price, once you add it, the fair value is going to be higher. Now, therefore, what is it that in which situations can we use the intrinsic value? Obviously, it is the situation where you can't use the Ind AS 102. So look for a moment into the SEBI share-based guideline, which I have given you. Here again, I've highlighted relevant sections. You can see from this that the it actually refers to the guidance note issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants. See here in this, any company implementing any of the share-based scheme shall follow the guidance, the requirements of the guidance note on accounting for employee share-based payments or accounting standards as may be prescribed by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India from time to time, including the disclosure requirements prescribed therein. So therefore, when you look at companies which are listed also, they refer actually to the guidance note or the accounting standard which has replaced them. So here you have the basis for you to refer to the guidance which is given in either Ind AS or in the guidance note. Okay, so let me go back for a moment to the guidance note. So the guidance note is basically establishing the financial accounting and reporting principles for employee share-based payment. What the guidance note also does is that it gives you the purpose, as it just classifies the accounting into three types, and which are the equity settled options, the cash settled options, or the employee share based payment plans with cash alternatives. Okay, now let me go to schedule and come back to this point 12 in a moment. See, there is this appendix 6, which is on graded vesting. And here, this is where the entire report which we have taken to justify intrinsic value is, this is the basis of us to take the intrinsic value. So here, for instance, you have 300 options into 1,000 employees into 25%, and there is an attrition rate of 3%, which has been expected here. And therefore, the number of options which are expected to vest are captured. Similarly, at the end of 2 years, it will be an additional attrition of 3%, and therefore the number of options expected to vest is lower. And similarly, in the third year, you have multiplied the attrition rate is another 3%, and therefore you come to the number of options which are here. Now, therefore, this compensation cost, when you look at it, is divided across the, based upon the vesting years, vesting dates, year one, year two, year three, the expected options which are, the options which are expected to vest, the value per option, and the compensation cost is captured here. And this is exactly the method which we have followed, if you've seen, in our spreadsheet. Okay. So therefore, whatever we have done in the spreadsheet is based upon this guidance note. Let me go back to the point 12, which I took you from when we left. What you can see in the guidance note is some of these factors which you need to keep in mind. Top level executives tend to hold their options longer than middle management, and lower level tend to exercise their options earlier than any other group. Therefore, if you feel that there is a need to differentiate the classes of options, you differentiate the classes of options. What this means is that there is more complexity in your model, in the sense that you're just having additional vesting dates or additional groups of employees, which you will, and different periods you will use in your option model. So this is one factor which you need to keep in mind while building your model. Now, the factors which we need to consider, whatever we referred to so far, are all captured here. This is what we have actually been using, the implied volatility, the historical volatility, the length of time, the tendency of volatility to return to its mean. All of these factors we've actually captured into our report. Now, there's one interesting thing which you will notice in the case of unlisted enterprises. What it says for unlisted enterprises is that the enterprise could consider the historical volatility of similarly listed enterprises, or alternatively, see this, all the volatility of unlisted enterprises can be taken as zero. Okay, so what this does is it gives you a way out. And if you're going to use volatility of unlisted enterprises as zero, just refer to the guidance note. I don't know if that's really the right thing to do, but you have an accounting basis on which you can take your volatility down to the number which you want to use there. Okay, now let me also take you to the basis of another factor which you need to keep in mind. See, what this guidance note says first and foremost is that you should be using the fair value method as much as possible. However, it also gives you the ability to use the intrinsic value method. And then let's look at that. Where is that section which talks about the intrinsic value method? Let me just search for this for a moment. Give me a moment, please. If you look at the guidance note from para 40 onwards, let me go to that. See, that is actually the intrinsic value method which is justified here. Now, the intrinsic value method is something which has been justified in the standard. See, what it says is that accounting for employee share-based payment plans dealt with here too before is based on the intrinsic, is based on the fair value method. There is another method known as the intrinsic value method for valuation of these plans. And this is, it explains as to what it is that can be done on the intrinsic value method. And this is basically what you're following. However, when it comes to disclosures, what it's saying is that in case you follow the intrinsic value method, you still need to make the disclosures as per the fair value method. And that is what we are actually doing in our report when we are calculating the option values under both methods. Because what it says is where an enterprise uses the intrinsic value method, it should also disclose the impact on the net results and EPS, both basic and diluted for the accounting period, had the fair value method been used. It would be also describing a description of each plan, etc. So all of this needs to be put in the disclosures. Now, does any of this come into your report? No, this doesn't have to come into your report, but this is what the company is actually going to be doing when it prepares the note, the disclosure, the notes to the financial statements will actually have disclosures of the fair value. So that's where your report actually gets used. Okay. It will be, your report therefore should contain enough data for them to populate this note to the financial statement, because the disclosures are what they're doing based upon whatever your report is containing. Okay, now let me go for a moment to the Ind AS 102 to explain what is the difference between the two. What we've seen is that the guidance note permits us to use the intrinsic value, whereas if you look at Ind AS, it covers basically the basic framework of it is exactly the same. The only principle which you need to keep in mind is that under Ind AS, in Ind AS, it basically says that you can't use, it doesn't say that you can use the intrinsic value method. The only circumstance in which you can use the intrinsic value method is when you don't have a fair value. Okay, so let me take that point for a moment. So here you can see what the standard says. The requirements in paragraph 16 to 23 apply when the entity is required to measure a share-based payment transaction by reference to the fair value of the equity instruments granted. In rare cases, the entity may be unable to estimate reliably the fair value of the equity instruments granted at the measurement date in accordance with the requirements in paragraph 16 to 22. In these rare cases, only the entity shall instead measure the equity instruments at their intrinsic value. Okay. But the difference between our intrinsic value calculated and the accounting which is done as per Ind AS and as per the guidance note is that once you fix the intrinsic value, you will use that same cost year to year. Whichever be the year, you will use the same difference in the intrinsic value, which is the intrinsic value on the grant date. However, here you'll see in Ind AS that what it says is that you're going to change it. Okay, so the Ind AS is basically saying that you change the amount which is recognized based on intrinsic value in the P&L account, which is a difference. It's a big difference. Now, we have not covered things which are like modifications, etc. But suppose there are modifications, and this requires a more detailed conversation in case we get into it. The sum and substance of modifications is that in case there is something which is modified, you do the modifications in the cost going forward. So when you get information from management, get hold of the modifications which they've done in the plan, which can be by way of, let us say, extending the grant period or reducing the grant period or changing the vesting price. You find out the modifications, find out the impact, and account it going forward. That's the principle in accounting here. Now, suppose there's a cancellation. What happens is that the cost up to the date of cancellation gets accounted as cost, and the rest of it is then the option gets cancelled, and therefore there is no further cost. In the case of cash settled share based transactions, the principle which you follow here is that is very simple. It's accounted as a liability. So every period, you just true up the value of the liability, and that's all that needs to be really done in cash settled options. And it's just like any other liability which we account for. All that you need to do in the case of cash settled share based payment transactions is to calculate what is the value of the liability and just true it up in the financials. Okay, so this is comparatively easy to do if it is cash settled. Your problem comes more in case it is equity settled, in which case then you just have to go through the option pricing models and do whatever it is that you need to be doing there. Okay, so with this, I'll just open out for questions. I'm sure that there are people who have questions in this, and let's hear from them.
Anyone can raise hand so that participants can unmute themselves also.
Okay, so let me take up Vijay Mehta's question. Do we need to consider options that are likely to lapse at the time of grant date ESOP valuation? So Vijay, are you referring to options which lapse within the option period or after the, I mean, within the accounting period or after the accounting period?
No, at the time of grant, yesterday, there was a discussion about considering the probability of persons who will leave the employment and all that.
That's right, Vijay. So if you saw, I referred you to the graded vesting and I briefly showed you the guidance note where there was a 3% attrition rate which was considered. So basically what you take is that whatever be the cost of the options which you take, you multiply by 97% because that is the only cost you're going to account. The 3% attrition rate you will not consider. So your model, see in my model which I've given you, I've not considered attrition rate. You have to make a modification for attrition rate.
For a valuation that won't be relevant, right? That is relevant only for accounting the cost.
Yeah, but basically what the company is asking you for is to give the accounting cost. So therefore, in your model, you have to modify it like it has been done by Anjan to include the attrition rate. You have to include the attrition rate. That's important.
Okay, thank you, thank you. Okay.
Can attrition rate be based on MRL if it is reasonable?
So you can base it on MRL. What you also need to keep in mind, Shilpa, is that for startup companies, quite often they can't estimate what is their attrition rate. They just don't know. So you can safely take the management representation. If they say that, no, everybody is going to be with us, that's why we're giving them options. You can safely take a rate of even zero. Okay, but the next year, the second year onwards, you actually use the data which is there.
Abraham sir, my question is that in case of especially unlisted company, suppose they have granted shares 1 or 2 years back, and now the scenario like this COVID exists. Now the question remains is that the fair value of the shares at the time of grant, what could have done by the valuation report of that particular time. Now the question is that as of today's scenario, you can see that perhaps that fair value has substantially reduced. So in that case, how we should put it into the valuation and how we should take it about?
Okay, so this I will ask. This is a very good point, actually, Harshad, and I will ask others also to chip in, maybe Joy. See, the way in which I look at it is that I have done, let's say, a valuation which was dated, let's say, December of last year, and I've come to an option price of using size example of 12 rupees. Now, therefore, I've calculated based on this that the option grants which are there after that at 12 rupees, there's an intrinsic value which I'm using, which I'm writing off over the service period in future. Okay. Now, what's happened as of today is that my price has actually fallen from 12 rupees to, let us say, 6 rupees. Okay. So your question is, should I be considering 6 rupees and writing off the cost based on 6 rupees? What I would do is that I would not. All the grants which are done as of the grant date, whatever is the option value, that is the amount which I take for amortizing my cost. Okay. That's the approach which I would follow.
Abram, so I too have a question.
Yeah, so this is Joy here. So what Abraham is saying is correct, actually. So subsequent changes in the share price don't impact the accounting at all. Unless the company goes ahead and revises the plan.
You're right. So suppose we change the, based upon the, the grant price to something else. Then you have changed the plan and therefore you could change the price. You're right.
Sir, in fact, that's what is happening these days. You can perhaps see some of the cases. Now, these companies, their projections and these things have gone for a tremendous change. I mean, so otherwise it will be, you know, unnecessary. We will be provisioning for the higher expense in the employee cost.
And, right.
No, so basically, so when the plan is revised, basically a whole lot of upfront expense has to be taken at that point in time. So that is how the accounting works. It's specified very clearly in the guidance note and in Ind AS 2. But when the plan is revised, effectively the effect of the change in plan straight away goes into P&L at that point in time itself.
Practically you have to look at it, you know, that during the COVID you are doing a valuation, or prior to that, you know, that when you are doing a valuation, what happened is that day the price was prevailed.
Right.
So obviously, you know, that corrections during the COVID may not arise. That is what I feel.
Yeah. So that's Shivdat, that's actually a good point. I mean, will the values actually change due to COVID is something which is a different discussion, right? Because if the company is a well-set company, it should probably be getting over COVID. And what we discussed, I think, in Anjan's session.
And logically, you know, that if you look at startups, you know, that if it is a continuing startups, you know, that it can make out, you know, that it crossed the hurdle of COVID, you know, it can fetch the similar price over a period of time also.
That's right. What can possibly change due to the COVID valuation is that for a period of 2 years, let's say that the cash flows go negative. Now, after 2 years, the valuation is exactly the same. However, therefore, on an overall basis, it's possible for the valuer to come and say the value of my company has deteriorated as of today. Okay, because it'll take 2 years for the company to get back to normal. Okay, therefore, that could be a value fall. However, option cost, which is there for options already granted, will not change. Okay, so that's one important thing. Now, strictly speaking, when you look at options, there are two factors. And this we discussed in the conversation with Divya. Now, there are actually two factors. One is the fair value of the option, and second is the vesting, the number of options which are going to vest. Now, the fair value of the option is not changing. Okay, for the purpose of the grant which has been done pre-COVID, post-COVID, the fair value is not changing. What can change is the number of options which are vesting. Now, suppose you had, let us say, a market link condition for the vesting of options, and that's something which you have to figure out. If you have a market link condition, then the number of options vesting changes. If the number of options vesting changes, then obviously your cost will change. Okay, so that is something which you have to figure out, Vijay. To answer your question, will things change? Or Harshad, will things change based upon the COVID scenario? If there is a market link condition in the vesting of options, the number of options vesting can change, and that you have to consider. I hope that's clear. Okay, so Ganesh has a question. Shivdat, is there something else which we need to handle, answer? Okay, so Ganesh Ramani says, any cost reversal that was accounted in the previous years is allowed if the options are cancelled. You're right. That is when you come to modifications, and is it possible? So cost reversal, Ganesh, let me say that once cost is booked, the cost is booked. Okay, so there is no going back on the cost. But what happens is on the liability side, which is where the stock options are lying, where the stock option cost is lying, that is a cost which gets taken into, based on accounting, it would get taken into a general reserve, right? It would not get taken into capital. See, let's assume that the stock options outstanding as per the standard is something which is lying in between, let us say, the general reserve and the share capital. Now, therefore, you have a separate head, which is stock options outstanding. Once the options are exercised, the liability goes into the share capital. Now, suppose the options are cancelled, it cannot go into share capital. It cannot remain in share in options outstanding. Therefore, when they are cancelled, it goes into general reserve. Harish Adanki is saying, cash settlement of options, can we ignore option calculation and reporting of option pricing methods? Yes, so that's what we discussed, Harish. What we said is that we would you have to first and foremost, I think that you need to have it in your report as to what is the nature of the option and what is the treatment which is required. So in your report, if you say that this is something which is going to be cash settled, then you should outline what is the liability in your report. Because as far as the report is concerned, you will have the amount of the liability. And it's a lot of it will be based on management's representations. However, the fair valuation is what you're saying. Can the fair valuation be ignored? You have to see the nature of the option, I believe. If the liability is computed based upon certain valuation parameters, then it will still be used.
But majorly, what we are discussing now is equity settled options and not cash settlement of options, right? Normal scenario.
That's right. Most of our options are equity settled. Cash settled options are different. So there are different notes also which you would use in the financial statements for cash settled options. So Chetan is saying, is that okay, Shilpa? I mean, do I have to answer anything more to you? No. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Chetan. Fair value to be disclosed in report, even if we go for intrinsic value for computing the value of the options, it means we have to calculate both in any case. That's right. So as far as the guidance note is concerned, even if you're using the intrinsic value method for the purpose of booking the cost in the P&L account, you still have to put the fair value disclosures in the notes to the accounts.
So we need to get two valuation done, no? One for calculating fair value of share and another is ESOP valuation.
That's right. You need a fair value as well as intrinsic value. Okay.
And that you're
talking
fair value
of something else. Right. You're talking of the stock valuation. You're relying on stock valuation for the purpose of getting to the fair value of the stock. Now, your option report is actually calculating the fair value of the option. So suppose your stock is, in my example or in size example, the stock was valued at, let's say, 12 rupees based upon the stock valuation report. Based upon the ESOP valuation report, there is a value to the option which is there, which is over and above.
Yeah, so we need to get another valuation done. Firstly, we need to get a valuation done to compute the fair value of share of unlisted company, and then we can use it for ESOP valuation.
Yes, yes.
Is there any other way out as well if the company don't want to get the fair valuation done for the stock? Can we rely on face value or management estimate of the fair value of the company?
Okay, so that's actually a good point. And it's something which I don't agree with. Okay, Ruchi. So yeah. I've actually seen an auditor of one of the companies where I am involved who has taken the net asset value as per income tax. He has done a net asset value calculation as per income tax to calculate what is the equity share value. Okay. And from that, he's minusing the grant price. And that is the value which he's accounting as a stock option cost. Now, I will ask people on this call as to whether that's right or not, because that's what he has actually used. If you look at Ind AS, it says that net asset value can be used. Okay. But in the absence of a fair value, if you have a fair value, you can't use a net asset value. You can't use intrinsic value. You can't use net asset value.
Okay, so and Abraham, I'll just add there that it doesn't say in the absence of fair value. It says where fair value cannot be computed.
Correct. You're right, Joy.
So where fair value can be computed, it needs to be computed.
And that fair value... that fair value report...
So either the fair a third party can do that fair value report, or we can do it as a separate assignment.
Practical situation for this problem is that what happens in the most
that the fair value should be done from.
Yeah, so you get the assignment and do the fair valuation also, Ruchi. You do both.
Yeah, and that fair valuation can be done by a chartered accountant, merchant banker, or a registered valuer. No problem at all, no? Because it is not required as per.
No problem at all.
But in practical situation.
Thank you so much.
What happens is that most of the, you know, the ESOP comes in with pre-series A. You know that for pre-series A, you do a valuation anyway. So same valuation can be used for ESOP also. This is where, you know, that the practical experience is that, you know, that during that time only the startups comes out with the ESOP scheme.
You're right. Yeah. So, but always there is a value available, right? In all the series, Shivdat, there is a value available.
Correct.
The issue is that sometimes some of these people want to use net asset value in their ESOP calculations.
So, I mean, you can't use a net asset value if the company is a going concern as a strong track record of the company showing strong growth, right? So, I mean, a net asset value would not be the right approach.
Correct. I don't agree with it, but there are companies which do it and chartered accountants who are accepting it in their financial statements. Okay, so there's one question, which is, can the ESOP report be can be done only by registered value, or can a CA do the same? The CA can do the same. I think that we've just discussed it. And also, it can be done by an actuary. So actuaries' reports are also relied upon. So ESOP valuation reports, there is no restriction on who can do it. It can be done by any qualified person.
No, I guess that may not be the correct view, because ESOP valuation is under the Companies Act. And today, under Section 247 of the Companies Act, it is incumbent that a registered valuer does it.
So, Adarsh, let me...
It will not be, may not be the sole option in there.
So, Adarsh, let me just mention that when it comes to... there is no section which actually asks a company to do an ESOP valuation. Okay. If there is, you point me out to it.
No, sir. The issue is that there is no section which actually asks you specifically for ESOP valuation. But the Section 247 says that all valuations under the Companies Act are required to be done by registered valuer.
No, Adarsh, that is incorrect. There are only very few sections in Companies Act which require a registered valuer to do a valuation. There are a number of other sections in Companies Act where a registered valuer need not do a valuation. A valuation can be done by anybody. So there is actually, if you look at the internet and all, you'll find there are enough tables floating around which say which are the sections under which registered valuer is to do a valuation.
But as per Section 247, it is mentioned that every valuation in the Companies Act will be done by registered valuer.
It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that. Please read Section 247.
Okay, maybe I might be wrong. Yeah, okay. I'll read once again.
It doesn't say that.
Okay, so for
I'm just reading out of Section 247. It says where a valuation is required to be made in respect of any property, stocks, shares, debentures, securities, or goodwill. Right, that is what Section 247 starts with. So,
yeah, and what does it say further?
So, there is no exception to this.
So, Adarsh, it actually refers to certain sections.
So no. It doesn't. It's, you know, the point on the.
Yeah, Adarsh, the point I think is very much clear. I think Abraham sir told is that Companies Act specifies certain provisions under which the valuation report has to be obtained from the registered valuer only. So there are certain 8-10 provisions under which it mandates that the valuation has to be done only by a registered valuer.
No, my view is let us please read it, because it clearly now says.
And there is a legal opinion on this.
This is a structure that's come by as an amendment on 23-10-2017. And it says a person having such qualification and experience registered as a valuer and being a member of an organization recognized in such manner on such terms and conditions as may be prescribed. So it has to be a registered valuer. This is effective 23-10-2017. So please go through section 247. I personally believe that's the view in chartered accountants is also taken, but my view is that I don't think this is a great.
So technically speaking, ESOP valuation is not under the act. It is under the guidance note or the accounting standard.
Sorry.
It pertains to a share, and share is not governed by any other statute than the Companies Act. Even SEBI is subservient to that in terms of an equity.
So let me ask Shivdar to intervene. He was wanting to say something.
Under section 62, you know that unlisted companies, it is section 62 which deals with this thing. As far as my opinion is concerned, you know that wherever ROC insists on a registered valuer, as far as there are two certificates are basically obtained, valuation certificate, one for the Income Tax Act. Income Tax Act doesn't specify that registered valuer as on date. But as far as the MCA is concerned, you know that they insist on a valuation certificate from the registered valuer.
The purpose of ESOP.
ESOP.
Actually, Abhinav. So there are two elements. One is that when an ESOP plan has to be approved by the shareholders, that time a valuation is required, which may be required to be done by the registered valuer. But then there is a second valuation required, which is for accounting purposes. I would also like to throw some light in as per income tax,
a chartered accountant can do valuation only by using NAV method, because it is specifically provided in the income tax. Merchant banker can do only using DCA valuation can be done only by merchant banker.
No. So that is for the different types of transactions. What merchant banker can do and what chartered accountant can do are different types of transactions. They are not similar transactions.
Sir, in 16th, hello, Hari Surya here. IBBA has given a circular on 16th September 2019 saying that what are the valuations are required under the Companies Act. It says that 62(1)(c) that with rule 13(1) further issue of capital.
Correct. So that is a different valuation than an accounting valuation.
No, yeah, correct.
Yeah, accounting valuation can be done either by chartered accountant or by registered.
Yes, exactly.
But whatever the valuations are prescribed in the Companies Act, that can be done by registered valuer only. In case of FEMA, valuation of capital with less than 5 crore can be done by chartered and more than 5 crore by merchant banker. If we are raising the funds from a company outside the
Let me just intervene. I know that different people will have different views. I mean, Adarsh also has a different view, but let's agree to disagree for the moment. Now, subject to what Shivdat is saying, that if, let's say, the MCA is actually asking for a valuation report to be given at the time when we file details of the stock options which are granted, then we have to give a valuation report which they will accept. Okay, but if it is not required at that point of time, for the purpose of accounting, we need just a valuation report which can be signed by a chartered accountant, or it can even be an actuary. And I've seen reports signed by actuaries.
Totally agree with this point.
And also, at the time of filing with ROC, what you need is a share valuation report. You don't necessarily need an ESOP valuation report.
Yeah. You know that many companies have a practice of taking a merchant banker's valuation on. Because one company where I worked in a largely sizable company where they used to take a merchant banker's valuation. The reason, you know, that since there is no limitation that it should be obtained from a chartered accountant or actuary or a merchant banker's valuation, you know, that companies are going in a different direction, because this is the most challenged issue. I think sometime back we have discussed also, it started with Infosys, you know, that there are three major judgments which have come, you know, that some of the judgments are against the company, and one or two judgments which has been high, Madras High Court judgment is favorable to the company, and Bombay High Court judgment is against the, that it's in favor of income tax. So people are, coming out with, just to say from the income tax angle, various this thing, they've been taking a valuation certificate from a different, that reputed merchant bankers also they've been taking.
Okay.
I think the statutory auditor also should desist, and any chartered accountant in practice other than statutory auditor should be taken.
Statutory auditors anyway will not give a certificate. That is a different issue.
Did anyone jot down the statutes under which the ESOP valuation is required? Like, it is not required in Companies Act, it is required in Income Tax Act, and as far as I know, it is required for accounting purposes.
Even in Income Tax Act, ESOP valuation is not required. Under Income Tax Act, valuation of shares is required by a merchant banker on the day the employee exercises the ESOPs.
Okay. Now, so
when the shares are allotted to that person.
Now,
that is a valuation by a merchant banker.
Okay.
So, which is under Income Tax Act?
Accounting aspects where it is, that it is questioned is that, charge on P&L will be a question by, that many a case is questioned by Income Tax. That is why the valuation certificate plays a very crucial role there.
Yeah, for the accounting cost.
Just to recognize the cost.
But that's been settled by the Biocon case, right?
It has been settled by, because I was the one who has handled that case.
Awesome.
In fact, what happened is that the tribunal has been, that upheld. But there are, Madras High Court was favorable and Bombay High Court was against. So I think matter is before the Supreme Court, must be now. So I'm not sure that what is the development in that aspect in the, before the Supreme Court.
So you're talking about the expense to be claimed by the company.
Correct. Which is fair.
That is where the valuation, report plays a very crucial role there.
Right. Okay. So now that we've reached 9 o'clock, I think that...
Last question I have. If you don't mind.
Yes, Chetan, carry on.
I have observed that some of the companies, grant the options at the time of joining of each of the employees. So in such case, whether we should do the option valuation at each grant date, and also the spot price has to be arrived at each grant date, considering it's unlisted company.
That's right. You have to do it for each grant date, otherwise you will not get it correct, because the period of each option of vesting is different, correct? So for instance, suppose in general, we have given all the options on, let us say, 1st of September. And then after that, one senior employee joins on 1st of January. We can't combine both the option grants. Okay, so 1st of September grants will all be taken and the cost calculated separately. 1st of January cost will be calculated separately.
And even the spot price has to be calculated separately.
On those two dates, you will take the fair value as of those two dates. That's right.
Okay.
There is a point which has been... Thank you, Chetan. I think Ravi wants a speaker to join for us. So, Ravi, can I continue for one more question maybe, and then I'll move on to this?
Narendra is also raising question in hand from that time.
Okay.
I also have one question.
Okay, so then let me ask... if you don't mind, let me just ask Ganesh Ramani as to what he means. So he has given a reference to section 62(1)(c) and he has said that the section refers to existing shareholders, rights issues, stock option plan, other persons mentioned above, the price of the share to be determined by the report of a registered valuer. 62(1)(c) is for... So Ganesh, let me just say that rights issue does not require a valuation report. Okay, that would be... That is 62(1)(a), 62(1)(b) and 62(1)(c). Okay, so 62(1)(c), which is a preferential allotment, we need. Okay, but the other two sections, we don't need. They have not referred to a valuation report. And you can correct me if I'm wrong there.
Abraham, please refer to 62(1)(c). There are two components. They specifically mention about ESOP issued. Please read the other part, employees under the scheme of employee stock options. And especially in all IBBI webinars and discussions that are happening for the registered valuer, it has been specifically stated that unless prescribed by the statutes of SEBI or RBI or other places, which are income tax, if they do not specify anything else, registered valuer means a valuer registered under IBBI, number one, and you cannot have any disclaimers, because all registered valuers are under the liability now whenever they are giving a report. It's not an open-ended where you can sign anything. So well, someone said that it's just an accounting cost, it has no implications. That is not accepted, because that cost what you're reflecting has an impact to the all kind of stakeholders, and therefore reports are to be coming from a registered valuer. This is
what Ganesh says is right. What Ganesh says is right.
Sir, 621C is for allotment of shares. So there we are not valuing the options. We are valuing the stock for which registered value is required. What we are talking about now is valuation of options. As Joy sir said, valuation of option is not required, mandated by the law, but by Ind AS. And that's the reason valuation can be done by anyone.
The one that I have copied here, is in the message, you can see existing shareholders and second one specifically employees under the scheme. Anyways, I think some more clarity if we want, we can always get. As I said,
I put it across to you very clearly. There are three valuations which we are, you know, that approximately three, you know, that if it is a cash-based valuation year on year, which is required. Otherwise, you know, thumb rule says that three valuations are required. One is for the allotment of shares for which a registered valuer holds good. One for the Income Tax Act, I think Mr. Joy has already mentioned that is for the perquisite calculation. That is a merchant banker's valuation. Third valuation which we are talking about, debating, is that for accounting purpose, how much will be the charge to the P&L to determine that, you know, that option valuation which we have discussed now is applicable. For that, you know, that all the argument is going on saying that whether the chartered accountant's valuation is required or registered valuer's valuation is required. This is purely for the accounting purpose, you know, that like a gratuity, you know, that how the actuary gives a valuation, similar way whether, you know, that to take a charge in the books, you know, that there is a valuation which is required, which we are debating on now.
Sir, with due respect, actually that is not the correct view, because option is in respect of the share, and section 247 clearly says that any report in respect of the share has to be signed by the registered valuer. So what Ganesh says is right. And that's been the preponderant view by IBBI, as also even SEBI for that matter.
Sir, the section 247 also says where a valuation is required to be made. So required to be made under the Act is what we need to read it as, in my humble opinion.
So the guidance note of the Institute of Chartered Accountants is under the statute.
No, it is not. It's a guidance note. It's not a statute, is my humble opinion, sir.
So the structure is that the guidance note actually follows, and it actually, the first preamble in the guidance note is about share payments, and share is a constituent of only one statute in the country called the Companies Act.
I would like to add here, just so that, first of all, whenever we are in doubt, we should go back to the preamble and statement of the objects. Why did this entire registered valuers came under IBBI? The previous valuations, when you say for accounting purpose or for any disclosure purposes, that had an implication of no liability to the persons who are signing largely. And to that, when things were going all right, then everyone was brought under IBBI. It's not about someone has a great qualification. They were brought under that, and now registered valuer is far more accountable for everything that he signs up. And because
Ganesh,
of...
Ganesh, you're right. 100% right.
I have
a small issue. One more issue. You know, yeah. Abraham sir just mentioned about the fact that NAV is not a very methodology. Well, I believe that it is industry specific. In today's scenario, for example, the hospitality hotel industry would be preferred to be valued at NAV rather than an other methodology. So I think it will be industry specific in some of the structures. And since also the statute says clearly any good international or best international methodology that's to be adopted, I think NAV would be basically to be assessed on the industry-specific scenario.
Mr. Sharma, the International Valuation Standard as well as the ICI Valuation Standard talk about the cost method. Correct. And under that, they don't mention NAV at all. They mention either the replacement cost or...
I accept,
that is the market value of the asset.
I accept your point that NAV has to be marked to market to basically comply with the statute per se.
So just taking balance sheet numbers is not enough.
I agree. But the mark to market structures to make it direct replacement cost or reproduction cost method has
correct,
to be.
Correct.
I accept.
Okay, so this is actually very interesting that we are having a big debate upon this topic. Let's agree for the moment to disagree here. But we'll put out a further, we'll go into this a bit more in detail maybe in our next session. Let me just point out that, let me just repeat once again, there are a couple of questions which we can take.
But let me point out that on Thursday evening, we would like to get Uttam Padiwal to take a session on income tax treatment of stock options. Uttam, that's okay with you, right? At 7:30 on Thursday evening.
That's fine, okay. Sir.
Okay, so Ravi, this is what you had wanted us to indicate. I hope that's okay with you.
Yeah, that's fine, because the tax aspect was missing and a lot of people wanted a clarity on that.
Okay.
Which should be the initiative.
Sir, one last question. I mean, two questions. One is important and another is very basic. So the important question is, what is the range of fees which a valuer can charge for issue of ESOP valuation report, considering every scope, like where fair value is to be done by us, or binomial is used, Monte Carlo is used. So what is the range?
Okay, so let me just put it in the context, Sheetal. Suppose, let's say, for instance, the when you have access to the fair value report, you'll probably know what is the fee which has been charged for the fair value report, okay, which is the stock valuation report. So I think that an ESOP valuation report cannot be charging more than that. So that keep that one factor in mind. However, based upon the complexity of report, like we discussed in the previous session, if it's a binomial model, it's probably going to cost less as compared to it's going to cost more as compared to a BSM model, and a Monte Carlo, you should charge more. So the more the complexity, the more you should charge. Okay. So if you're asking...
Okay, so the minimum starts, it has to be lesser than fair value report, the valuation report which considers fair value.
Yeah, that I think you can use as a reference point, but if you want to charge more, you can, as long as the company is ready to pay you, there's no issues.
So do both valuations, sir.
Yeah.
And the basic question was, you said that you can link your Word file with Excel file. So is it possible? I mean, when you say that you can link Excel and Word, does it mean that numbers will not, when you change numbers in Excel, automatically the respective numbers will get changed in Word too?
I think that I will leave that to people who are better equipped at answering that as compared to me. Because
unfortunately, no, as yet.
Okay.
So file becomes.
I thought when you said that you can just
paste as a link, it automatically refreshes.
Yeah.
You can do it, but the file becomes too huge, too bulky.
Yeah. Or else maybe the better method is to put your entire report in Excel. Then you don't have a problem.
Okay, those were the questions. Thank you very much.
Okay, I have a question.
Yeah, Narendra.
Yeah. So somewhere in the presentation, I heard that the standard allows for use of zero
volatility.
As a volatility for an unlisted company, which is, which is a little bit surprising, because if there's no volatility, then why an option? My doubt is that it seems very unusual. What does the international standards say, and do you see any challenge to using a volatility like zero from the authorities or the auditors or whatever?
Well, that's let me just point out to the international guidance. Now, international guidance is completely fair value based most of the time. And fair value based will also mostly consider factors which are linked to volatility and so on. Okay. So the guidance note you have to remember is issued in 2005. Okay. So it's an old standard. And you're not going to find that in the Ind AS 102, which has been issued later. Okay. Where you can use volatility as equal to zero. So the point which I have to make here is that there is a reference in a guidance note to using volatility of zero for companies which are unlisted and probably are in a very early stage. There are no comparable companies. It's in a completely different market. You just have no, your guess at volatility is if it is just a shot in the dark. Okay, if you don't have an implied volatility, you don't have historical volatility, whatever number you put in volatility is what could be, there's a bias involved there. So that's what I think that the guidance note is referring to. In that case, maybe you can go to a zero volatility. But I would think that the standard, the international standard on accounting now is, all GAAP would basically require you to use volatility for options.
Hello.
So I can, you know, there's a paper on the internet on volatility, and it clearly says that you can pick up zero volatility only in circumstances, because most of the structures in the industrial scenario today are somewhat mature. You are not having any invention per se, and therefore you will find a comparable in the market. Having said that, you might get certain scenarios where you have certain patents, which are basically not a breakup of the existing scenarios. And therefore, you can pick up a volatility as zero, but you must explain it very cogently as to why you couldn't find a comparable to it. And you must actually spell that out in your report to basically clearly say that why was the option of a zero volatility done? Simply because everything in the world today is an old wine in a new bottle, even if it is artificial intelligence breaking things into a structure where you might probably believe that the idea is non-comparable, but you'll at the end of the day find it is a breakup of some other concept, and therefore comparables will be there.
Right. So thanks for explaining that, Adarsh. Naren, does it answer your question?
Yeah. It does, but I'm still a little saying I'll have to read that guidance note, because zero volatility means what? That means your grant price and strike price are same.
What it would mean is that the volatility of returns is something else. But basically, there is still a value to the option because of the life of the option, right?
Okay.
Carry on.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes,
Rajesh. I have one small question. How can I ensure that the fair value of option is correct? See, for example, in case of a DCF, sometimes we will be looking the EV by EBITDA, EV by enterprise value. So there we'll have a little control. Okay, this is what the comparable number, or 6x, 5x, or like that. Then we can just see the valuation report are in par with the valuation. So in case of the ESOP, so fair value of option which we arrived. So how can we ensure that this is the right number?
Okay, so let me give
you the control points basically. How can I ensure?
Yeah. I will refer it to others also, but let me just give you a point which you can keep in mind. See, typically when you look at the option values on the NSE, okay, and compare them to the stock price, you will find that at most of them, most of the options, even though they are, let us say, 3-month options or whatever it is, will not exceed something like about 10%. So if you have an option value, the fair value which is exceeding 10%, you know that something is wrong. Okay, if it is exceeding a 10% or maybe slightly higher number than that. Okay, so that is a control point which you should mentally keep in your mind, which gives you the reference point as to what is it that you should check. See, we have already mentioned that the longer the term of option, so suppose you have a 10-year option, okay, then it's very likely that the option value is far higher. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
As compared to an option which is, let's say, a 3-year option, because if you're having a 10% option value, when you're having, let's say, a 3-month option, then if you're going to 10 years, what is it likely to be? But however, in my mind, now what I've seen is that roughly about 10% by way of an option value is a point at which I'm comfortable. I don't have any issues with that really. But I'll refer to the others, whoever has more experience in this, please give a viewpoint.
So will we going to get in NSE India more than 10 years, for example, to predict a future or something?
No. What I'm saying is that you get option values on NSE.
On the valuation data.
At any point of time. No? So,
at any, okay.
So let's say as of today, for instance, you'll know what is the option value for purchase of a share. Okay, with a 3-month expiry. Okay, so you compare that against the stock price and see what is it as a percentage.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm saying use that as a reference point to figure out whether your option values are correct.
Yeah, because it's considering the various inputs and various statistical methods which we are using in this one, volatility, all those kind of things. Finally, one input will have a different value in terms of the fair value.
I understand your concern.
Yeah.
Okay. I understand your concern, Rajesh. What you're saying is that I'm an ordinary practitioner. Okay.
Okay.
I may not understand some of those Greeks and so on, but I need to have some conceptual clarity, some comfort points which I can use to ensure that my report when I give it is okay. Okay. So I've given you a sense of what you should be looking for. However, it's important that you should understand the theory behind it, because you saw that when Anjan spoke, that is very clear conceptual clarity about
what is it that is involved in the pricing. So the more conceptually clear you are, the more you are de-risking your report.
Correct.
Thanks.
So what I would also like to add here is that it is also a factor of what is the stock price and what is the strike price. So the intrinsic value, because that also plays a big role of what is the difference between the two. Effectively, you should consider the option value that you are arriving plus the strike price, the total versus the stock price, and then see what is the difference.
Right. It should be less than the stock price, ideally.
In many cases, it's higher.
So let me just give you that.
Because of the value of the option, because the option normally has a positive value.
Okay.
So let me just give the reference. What I was giving by way of a reference in the stock market, also Rajesh and Joy, is that when you look at stock market prices, now the option value is calculated on a strike price which is very close to spot. Okay. So basically, the option value is just above that. Okay. So Joy is saying, one of the biggest factors which affects the value of the option is the difference between the intrinsic value of the option plus some fair value of the option based upon the volatility and other factors. Okay. So if you look at stock market pricing, what you will find is that the strike prices there are very close to market. So therefore, the option price there which you have as a percentage to the stock market price is based upon a spot price at that point of time. Okay, and this is useful in the case of listed companies, because listed companies typically are issuing the stock at market price. Okay.
Thanks, sir.
Right. Okay, so Ravi, are we okay?
Another factor that goes into the option valuation is also the dividend yield. So if you have a higher dividend yield, then the valuation will be lower. Mm-hmm. And if you have a lower or zero dividend yield, then the valuation will be higher.
Right. You're right, Joy.
Hello, I am Ramesh here. I have one question.
Yes, Ramesh.
In this cash sector, in the share-based payment, what are the disclosures required in the case of IGAAP financial statement or Ind AS financial statement?
You'll have to repeat that question. That is, you're asking for Ind AS 102, when is it required and in what context?
What are the disclosure requirement in the case of cash settled?
Cash settled, sorry.
Yeah.
In the case of cash settled, what are the disclosure requirements which are there? Okay.
Yeah, so, in the financial statement. Yeah.
So when you look at, actually we've given you the guidance note as well as the Ind AS, and there are actually annexures in that which give you the disclosures which are required, Ramesh. I'll just refer you to that.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
It is there. Okay.
You're fine. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Now we'll conclude because it's already 20 minutes past 9 and many people are leaving. Two things now. One, I would request Chetan to give vote of thanks. Then I'll just do the concluding remarks and tell a few things about our next sessions. Chetan.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Ravindra. On behalf of Bangalore Valuers Association and all the participants of this session, I would like to thank Abraham sir for such an insightful and wonderful session. This session was very useful for all the participants as it helped us in enriching our knowledge on the overall ESOP framework. As the session covered a few of the important points like extract of SEBI guidelines on ESOP, guidance note of ICAI, Ind AS 102, and also on how to compute the fair value and intrinsic value. It also helped us in getting to know the contents of the reporting formats and some do's and don'ts. And you also helped us in connecting the elements of the reporting format with the finer points which were discussed in the earlier session. And I also, bring a point that Abraham sir played a very pivotal role in coming up with the contents of this 4-day session. Thanks a lot, sir. And I would also like to thank Mr. Ravindranath and Shilpa for taking pain and, you know, putting a lot of efforts in arranging this 4-day session. Thanks a lot for that. And I would also like to thank, last but not the least, all the participants in making the session so interactive and interesting. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chetan. Like, I would like to tell a few words about Bangalore Valuer Association. Many of people are asking how to become a member of this. We'll be sharing you the documents and the procedures how to become a member of this. As I already told you, like, we meet every second Saturdays and fourth Saturdays in the early mornings between 8 to 11 and have this kind of deliberations. Basically, this association has come together because a lot of new valuers have found this opportunity, have come into this, and many of us are amateurs in midst of people like Abram sir and a lot of many people who deliberated today. So we want to grow together in by taking their experience and also taking our excitement in this profession. And I thank everybody for contributing to this. And we'll be telling you a few more programs which are likely to schedule. One thing which we have scheduled for next Saturday, because that is our fourth Saturday. As per our schedule, we are having one more program that day. And that program will be about pitch deck, how to create a pitch deck, because pitch deck gives a very positive impact to a potential investor. We do our valuation and leave it at that stage. How does that get carried on to a potential investor? How your that your story, it's a story that a potential investor can get enrolled into. It's a value added to the client because he comes to you only, not only for valuation, you can also give him a pitch deck because you have created a lot of templates, you have done a research on that, and it becomes just a carry forward. It's a continuation of your research work, what you've done. And a good pitch desk is a boon, not only to you, but also to the client, to boon to you because you can improve your fees, like what Sheetal was asking, how much to charge. It's not only for ESOP, but also for a little more about the pitch deck. And the pitch deck gives a deep thought and attention and also gives a impact with its great designs, graphics, effective contents. At the end of the day, it's not only what you're speaking, it also what you're picturizing to an investor. In our earlier occasions, I have gone to expert and to take a pitch deck for my valuations, and the kind of fees they were charging was like a bomb. And I realized there is a huge potential in that aspect also. And we being valuers, only it is an added skill. If we get that skill, I think, again, our revenues will increase. So Bangalore Valuer Association, in association with Wheaton Advisors, a Pune-based consulting firm, is organizing a four-hour workshop on creating a good pitch deck. And Wheaton Advisors have got good experience for last decade where they have done a lot of successful pitch deck with the investors. And if you want to take up this opportunity to create your own pitch decks, and also if not creating a pitch deck, if you want to evaluate a pitch deck, I think this program is for you. And we are going to share the flyer as well as if you do the program, what kind of pitch decks you can create, what will be the output of the pitch deck, that format also we are going to share with you. If you are interested, kindly participate in this program. It will be very enriching. It will be for 4 hours, morning 8:30 to 12:30. And this will be a workshop. That means you are doing this program on your own. You'll be working through the organizers, in a sense, with the facilitators. Yeah, thank you. If I have missed out anything, I think I request Shilpa and Chetan and other persons to contribute to this.
I think many of you are aware of the pitch deck, but still for very few who may not be aware of it, it is the investor presentation. And basically, if any of the companies, especially startups, are trying to approach any professional investors, only the pitch deck goes. They will not even call for any, you know, discussion until unless the pitch deck is attractive and interesting and appealing to them. So the first point what a promoter will be looking at is, you know, who is available in the market for me, you know, to draft a pitch deck. So in this context, when I checked up for my clients, I also had a lot of problem. So this, I feel, you know, many of us also could be looking forward for this kind of workshop.
And I think
would also be like to part of this workshop. So
yeah, we'll be sharing the flyer with you in the group.
Okay.
I think also the case study will be covered in this workshop.
Correct. It'll be a case study and you'll be creating your own pitch deck at the end of the 4 hours. And also, I have shared a feedback form in the group and also in the chat. Request you to give your feedbacks. Your feedback is very valuable to us so that we can improvise on our next sessions. Thank you.
Yeah. So thanks to everybody, and especially from my side, thanks to Sai Kalyan for helping me in this session, and yeah. Also to.
Thanks, Sai.
So one more thing, if I can add. So one more thing. The session is very good. But it's just that we wanted recordings of this session so that we can understand in detail.
Yeah, all the recordings will be shared with you. File size was big. Today, a few people have worked on it and will be sharing in a YouTube format shortly. And rest of the PPTs and Excels all have been shared. In today's session, so Abram sir, anything else you need to share? Because I think you have given all the...
Yeah,
the
PPT is yet to be shared. Please share that as well.
PPT has been shared, right?
I've no, shared
specifically the calculation for report format.
I've
PPT and Excel both.
Yeah, I've sent it to Ravi also.
So PPT has actually been shared in the chat box.
Yeah,
so you can just look at.
Please share it in the WhatsApp group, please.
Yeah, we'll share it again. No issues.
Yeah, please share Excel also.
Excel both.
Yeah, and this 4-day seminar series is still not complete because. Abram sir has requested Uttam, and Uttam is working on it for completing us on the tax impact on
Excellent. Very nice.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you, everybody.
Right.
Bye.